Hello, I am Maurizio Ferrari da Crema, postdoc researcher at Politecnico di Milano, and today I'll be presenting a paper which we wrote together with two colleagues, Riccardo Nembrini and Paolo Cremonesi, both from Politecnico di Milano. ContentWise is sponsoring a PhD scholarship in this project. This work has been published at a entropy journal and is titled Feature Selection for Recommender System with Quantum Computing. Now, what are recommender systems? Recommender systems are one of the most successful and visible application areas of machine learning technology and are present in a variety of services that we use every day. Movie recommendation, music recommendation, product recommendation, friend recommendation, news recommendation, and so on. The list can go on forever. Their basic purpose is to help the user navigate the vast number of options that is at their disposal, and helping the user to find relevant results. They are known to increase user satisfaction, and therefore they are an important part of several business models. In this case, we will talk in particular about recommender system based on item-item similarity. What are they? Well, they work by computing a similarity between two items. In a content-based scenario, two items are similar if they have features in common. The more features they have in common, the more similar they are. In a collaborative setting instead, past user interactions are used to compute the similarity. Two items will be considered similar if users tend to interact with them in a similar way. These two strategies have pros and cons, of course. Collaborative filtering, so past user interactions, tend to have a very rich semantic content, and recommendation systems based on them have a higher recommendation quality. However, in a recommender system, we usually have only very few of the available items shown to the users. Think about Amazon, for example. You may have a million items in the catalog, but how many could you possibly buy in a few years? So there is only a tiny fraction of the items the user actually interacted with. And since we use past user interactions, if an item is new or is unpopular and has collected few interactions, it is difficult to build a reliable model for it. Of course, in this setting, collaborative filtering is impossible to use for new items because no data is available. In the picture here, you can see a plot which compares the number of interactions collected by different items in a typical dataset used in recommender system research. You can see that a very small fraction of the items has a high number of interactions, whereas the majority of items have very few. In cases where collaborative information is not available, we can use content-based methods. Content-based methods use information which is specifically related to the item, for example, the author, the genre, tags, extracted features from the audio track or the video track, reviews, and so on. The problem is that we end up with very large, noisy, and redundant feature spaces of tens of thousands up to hundreds of thousands of features. So the question here is, which of them actually represent the user behavior? Content-based methods tend to have lower recommendation quality, and so it is particularly important to do feature selection and weighting. Now, our model is called collaborative-driven quantum feature selection and tries to combine the two. So, what is the core idea? The core idea is that content-based and collaborative similarity models can have very different representations. The data is different, but also the similarities that they compute is different. So an item may be similar in one case, two items may be similar in one case, but not in the other. So the key idea is, since collaborative models work better when we have interaction data, we should select only the item features that allow the content-based similarity to mimic the collaborative one. We formulate this problem as a quadratic unconstrained binary optimization problem. So we have a minimization problem in this form. In our case, X is a binary vector containing the problem variables, one variable for each feature. One, the feature is going to be selected, zero, it will not. Q is a square matrix of size number of features times number of features, which will represent the problem to be solved. So now we have to find what is the loss function to represent our optimization problem. Again, the general idea is we want to mimic a collaborative model. So what we want to do is we want to keep the content-based features that represent the user behavior as it emerges in the collaborative model. We want to remove the content-based features that do not. Note here that we are comparing item-item similarities, but we want to build an optimization problem which will select features. So we will need to transition from an item-based problem to a feature-based problem. How do we achieve that? Well, the first step is we compute the similarity models. We can, it's very flexible as an approach because you can use any collaborative similarity model you want, a heuristic, a graph-based, machine learning model, whichever works best in your scenario. The second step is we compare the two similarities and build what we call the item penalization matrix. So the first thing we do is we look at the content-based similarity and at those items that have a content-based feature, a content-based similarity. Now, if the content-based similarity is present, we have two cases. If it is also present in the collaborative model, it means that those items are similar in both cases, and so we want to keep this similarity. Instead, if the content-based similarity is not present in the collaborative model, it means that we have a noisy representation, and those items should not be similar. This similarity should be removed. There's another case when the content-based similarity is absent. In this case, there's nothing we can do. We don't have the features. A particular case is when the content-based similarity is absent in the content-based model, but is present in the collaborative model. This means that there should be, we don't have enough features. We don't have a complete representation for the user behavior. Now that we have this penalization matrix, we transition from the item-based problem to the feature-based problem, and we compute the feature penalization matrix. The general idea is that a feature will inherit the penalties of the associated items. So if it is present in many similarities that need to be removed, it will tend to be removed. If it is present in many similarities that we want to keep, it will be kept. Then we can also select a we can also add a constraint to select a specific number of features to fine-tune the number of features that we want. We do this via a k-combination penalty. So overall, the resulting problem looks like this. We have two components. The first component is the feature penalty, as I've just described, and the second component is a feature number constraint, which is multiplied by a strength S, which we can use to tweak this parameter. Now, to our experimental pipeline. So let me summarize what we do. The first thing we do is we take items where we have collaborative information, we build a collaborative model, and we compute the Qubo problem. Then we solve the Qubo problem. There's a number of ways in which we can do that via the QPU with minor embedding, with hybrid quantum classical solvers, as well as some purely classical solvers. Then, once we have selected the features, we train a content-based model and we use it to evaluate on new items where no collaborative information is available. Now, there is a number of experiments and experimental analysis that we do in the paper. Let me summarize a few dimensions. We have a parameter to weight the similarity to keep and to remove, depending on how unbalanced the problem is. There's a possibility to select the desired number of features based on whatever criteria you prefer. And there's also a parameter for the selection strength in case the selection of the number of features does not produce the number that we want. Okay, now to the results. First, let me mention that this is not an analysis that was done on a toy example. Rather, it was done on three datasets, which are common in recommender system research. You see the movies dataset has 26 million interactions, 270,000 users, 44,000 items, and 3,000 features. Set you like A is a bit smaller, but has 8,000 features. And the Xing Challenge dataset has 5 million interactions, but only 79 features. Due to this, to address the problem, to solve the problem for the movies dataset and site you like, we use the Leap Hybrid Quantum Classical Solver, whereas for Xing challenge data, we use the D-Wave Advantage QPU directly. Now, we evaluated the approach on a number of dimensions. Here I'm going to report three evaluation metrics: recommendation accuracy through precision, NDCG, which measures the quality of the ranking, and item coverage, which tells us how many of the items in the catalog were actually used by the recommender. The higher, the better. Then we will use a few collaborative models: matrix factorization, linear machine learning, graph-based. Again, more details are in the paper. And a few baseline methods, such as a K nearest neighbor, a TF-IDF, which weighs features according to their frequency, and a machine learning feature weighting approach. Here I'm going to summarize the results for the movies dataset. First, if we look at precision, we can see that we have comparable results with baseline methods, better in some cases, but overall comparable. However, we achieved that with a drastic reduction in the number of features used. You can see that CQFS uses only 30% of features compared with 100% or 95% of the other approaches. Furthermore, this causes no reduction in the catalog exploration, which is still well above 60%, whereas in the other cases, it was lower than 50%. Now, as I mentioned, it is possible to solve the Qubo problem with quantum, but also classical strategies. In our experience, the QPU has a similar solution quality as other classical strategies, such as simulated annealing or taboo search. However, the Qubo problem is almost fully connected, which means that the QPU connectivity is a constraint due to the number of chains that need to be created to connect all the qubits. Overall, in our experience, quantum annealing has proven a reliable strategy, able to tackle problems of interesting size. Now, to mention briefly the computational time, we observed that the various solvers, classical and quantum, had similar solution time, accounting to the various preprocessing stages, of around 200 seconds. Even though the QPU is faster, once the problem has been formulated and embedded, the embedding time offsets this speed. However, we could see that compared with simulated annealing, both QPU and hybrid solver showed promising scalability. In the plots here at the bottom, you can see simulated annealing in red. And as you can see, the computational time of simulated annealing grows much faster compared to the other strategies as the number of features increases. Now, these results, as I mentioned, have been published. If you're curious, please check our paper. Here are the references. The paper is open access, and you have a QR code if you want to stop the recording and get the paper. We also provide the source code if you want to experiment and reproduce our results. I'll be available for questions. So if you have curiosities and want to know more about our work, please send me an email at the address in the last slide, and I'll be available at the live Q&A at the conference. Thank you very much for your attention.